Thank you.
Nelson.
Thank you.
Thank you. It was very general and very nice introductions that we have from Victor and Pamela. And I think that's going to help to more or less understand what Jeremy asked me to talk about, which is the case of Bolivia. Bolivia is a very small country in South America, landlocked, but has a lot of mineral resources and also natural gas and oil resources. And when you more or less analyze what happened in Bolivia since the initial years of the 20th century, what you find out is that really all related nationalizations or energy nationalizations are results of political and economic liberal models that enter into deep crisis. But at the same time, the oil sector was more or less healthy. Or we could say it was the only healthy industry in the country while the rest of the country was into crisis. And then that's more or less what explains why the oil industry becomes more or less the focus of frustrations and the focus of this nationalism attitude. In the nationalism that we see and that started in 2006 with President Evo Morales is the third wave of nationalizations that we had in Bolivia. The first was in 1939 when there was a war against Paraguay and the Bolivians lost the war. They lost territory, but they claimed that they defended the oil fields. Then the oil fields really didn't went to Paraguay. And at that moment, the country was completely devastated, and of course, the company, the foreign company that was there, Standard Oil, more or less looked healthy because also was accused of selling oil to the enemy of Bolivia, which was Paraguay. The second wave of nationalization started in 1969. If I'm talking about second wave of nationalization, it's because in between these 30 years, there was a privatization wave. And it's in 1969 that more or less is the same situation that happened with the third one with President Gonzalo Sánchez de Lozada. In 1967, 2 years before the nationalization, there was a military dictator called General Barrientos. A person who was, we could say in the modern terms, more or less neoliberal, but it was just called liberal at that time. And he, when you read what he wanted to do with the oil sector, was more or less what Sánchez de Lozada wanted to do in 1995. And what you find is just after 2 years of all his reforms that really didn't went to good successes, then it was nationalized. And all the anger was against the Bolivian Gulf Company, which was an American company. And we have now the third one, that's with 2006, with Sánchez de Lozada as president, and more or less, for the people who are not known, who doesn't know too much about the Bolivian case, he really implemented a very successful neoliberal model in the energy sector. And I'm going to go into details about what really did, but the results of that is that Repsol was there, Petrobras was there, British Petroleum was there, Shell was there, and it was the first time that really big multinational companies were in the natural gas sector in Bolivia. But that lasted only maybe 10 years. And then it was nationalized. But again, what you can see is that what happened in 2005 and 2002 and 2006 is that the country really entered into crisis. And these firms, Repsol, Petrobras, British Petroleum, and Shell, more or less looked like they were doing very good businesses. Then the question is, why these models of privatization, or why these models of liberalization really didn't work in the country? And from we can see is that in these three cases, what happened is that because the country entered into recession or into crisis, not only because of internal and domestic issues, but because of international and the international environment, what happened is that really these liberal governments cannot renegotiate with the oil firms and ask for more tax revenue. For some reason, the renegotiations with these firms fail, and then the state enters into deep crisis. The state has no resources, and just then, more or less, is the end of those governments. That's what happened in 67, 69. That's also what happened with Sánchez de Lozada in 2002 and 2004. But nationalization cannot be just, energy nationalization cannot be just explained because governments doesn't have the tax revenue or the funds to claim social demands from the population, but it's also that there has to be some triggers that really get the popular support to make these measures. Because we could say it's not that people all the time are gonna support nationalizations. I mean, Sánchez de Lozada and the president that I mentioned, this General Barrientos, were elected democratically. And they were elected with those proposals to privatize the energy sector. Then it's like the people also shifts their minds. It's not that always people want pure nationalization. Sometimes they want privatization. And in the case of Bolivia, the triggers really to go against the private ownership of oil or natural gas is that the criteria of the resources belong to the state. Ownership is one of the triggers. And the second is this idea of development based on industrialization. In the case of Bolivia, the idea that the resources underground belong to the state, and then when they come up or when they discover also belong to the state, is more or less something that comes since the constitution written in 1825, and it's kind of embedded in the conscience of the people for some reason. And then people easily are going to reject alternatives where the firm has free availability of extracted resources. In Bolivia, however, we have a little bit of difference because it's the West and the eastern part, or the highlands and the lowlands. In the highlands, that attitude is really very extreme, in the sense that people in the highlands really want the state to own all the resources, and if they see a state-owned company that's running the energy, they want that state company to receive all the oil or natural gas explored by the private industry. In the lowlands, it's a little bit different. There more or less says, it's fine if the private firm can get it, but if they pay a fair tax, it's okay. And then that has been more or less the entire debate in Bolivia between what we have to do with taxing oil companies. Then this fairness of 50-50 more or less has been the constant since 1939 in Bolivia. And that was only altered in 1996 with President Sánchez de Lozada, who instead of going with a 50-50 royalty scheme with the multinationals, he introduced a change of 18% for the state and 82% to the company. And that was really looked unfair by the people. That was being reversed. That was one of the strong reasons why Evo Morales really nationalized the oil companies in 2006. But, well, it was a little bit very particular nationalization because he really didn't want at the beginning in 2006 to get control of assets. He just wanted to renegotiate the tax terms with the companies, and he got the 50-50. And It's later on, 2007, 2008, and 2009, that he really nationalized also other assets from those companies. I would say that so far, the results of this attitude about ownership and the 50-50 has been successful, in the sense that the government has increased more or less the state revenue, I would say, in more than 10 times of what it was collected originally. This is based on the high prices of oil. We have been, Victor has been mentioning that the oil prices have been going down. In the case of Bolivia, this is more or less a little bit neutralized because they only have two clients, which is Brazil and Argentina. And the price is determined by a contract that more or less goes with a mix of different oil prices. And then today, for instance, the Argentinians are paying like $10 per million of British thermic units. The Brazilians are paying $8. And these are very high prices. I mean, if we compare those prices with what was happening in 2005 or 2006, well, it was around $2-3. And now they are paying $10 or $8. Then, in that sense, has been successful. In that sense, the nationalization has been given all these resources to the government. And it's going to last until those contracts are renegotiated or until Argentina or Brazil decides not to buy more natural gas from Bolivia. One idea of saying how much really this affected the countries by the level of monetary reserves. The reserves of the country are the highest ever. They are saying that it's 50% of GDP that the central bank has on reserves. Of course, this is a small amount. We're talking about just on the range of $13 billion, but it's 50% of GDP. This is enough for the government to run all the social programs, to run some other support to the small companies or small farmers and small manufacturing and PMEs. The unemployment is low, respect not only to Bolivia but Latin American countries. We're talking about 5.5% of unemployment. Of course, you can ask me how they measure that. In terms of GDP growth, has been between 4.5 and 5% in the last 6 years. This is not really the highest in South America. It's below what the Chileans, below what the Peruvians, below what Brazil has been doing. But it gives a lot of room to the government to continue with the program. Then at least the economy is not in crisis. As I said, in Bolivia, there's always changes in energy nationalism if the economy in general is poor, but not when the oil sector is not running. Then in this case, you have that the economy is still going well. The other trigger, in addition to ownership, is industrialization. There's also this idea that Bolivia is still in the 21st century thinking that the development is going to be based on natural resources. I mean, it's like they are not convinced that there's Dutch disease, they're not convinced that there's a resource course on all those things. And then in terms of industrialization, the evaluation is just that it failed completely. Industrialization for the Bolivian economy is to develop a petrochemical industry based on natural gas, to develop the iron ore lithium complex, and to develop a lithium complex in the Salar of Uyuni. All this cannot be, have not been done, have not been even started. There has been a lot of corruption in the state-owned company in order to do that. Do I have one more minute? Okay. And also, I'm going to explain this with your questions about foreign investment and YPFB, but really it didn't work. Just to end this, I would say that the costs of nationalization are very high in the short run, not only in monetary terms. It was more or less what they paid, $450 million. But it's very high in terms of the confidence and the image that the government has. It's going to be very, very hard to really attract foreign investment. Even the volume of natural gas is not enough to support the contracts with Brazil and Argentina. And I think in the next 3 years, we are going to see the limits of this model, because that's the point that you really are going to need more volume in order to support the low prices that we know are coming. And let me stop there, and I'm going to be happy to answer all your questions.
Thank you. Well, I'm going to try and go quick here so we can have some questions. It's funny, Pamela, you said your husband, you're going to talk about energy nationalism. I told my wife, I said, I'm going to have a panel, we're going to talk about energy nationalism. She said, what else is new? You can laugh. Look, the table has absolutely been set by these experts. David's book and his analysis of national oil companies is spot on. The role of national oil companies in Latin America is absolutely essential to anything we talk about. Pamela said ideology matters a lot. That is 100% accurate. I would add that history also matters a lot. And we heard Nelson talk about the cycles of Bolivia, the waves of nationalization, the cyclical economic situations, which leads me to the place I want to talk a little bit about, which is Argentina. And I'm going to run through some ideas about Argentina, and then we can talk and have a little discussion. And Pamela hinted at this. The current situation, the current energy nationalism environment in Argentina begins with the collapse in the beginning, about 10 years ago. The economic collapse in Argentina absolutely sets several things we've talked about here in motion. Obviously, Argentina being the center of that collapse is most relevant for that nation. In its role on energy, and what happened with the energy sector continues to this day, as I'll talk a little bit about. The Washington Consensus was vilified. The Kirchner government took over basically anything that had to do with sort of the capitalization, the idea that policies of the Washington Consensus, the IMF, the World Bank, became targets as they intervened, as the government became more interventionary in the economy. Right before the collapse, it's important to note, though, that Argentina had developed an incredibly robust natural gas sector. Anyone who's been to Buenos Aires has probably tried to put their suitcase into the back of a taxi and realize you can't because of the CNG tank. Well, natural gas in Argentina became an absolute essential element of their energy matrix. What happened with the collapse, directly a decision and the idea of the Kirchner government, as they vilified the Washington Consensus, but the choices they made to pull the country back from collapse and basically to try and resuscitate the economy, part of that was directed at the energy sector in the form of price caps, freezing utility rates, freezing the rates that consumers paid for natural gas, for electricity. And that really set in motion, obviously, the things we've talked about in terms of the intervention of the government in the sector. But it set in motion a range of things that continue to this day and impacts. And interestingly, when Nelson talks about Bolivia and the rents and the upside in terms of the fiscal stability of nationalization in Bolivia, well, you hadn't seen nationalization right after the collapse directly. You'd seen intervention, these price caps, but the policies in Argentina had a fiscal impact and a negative one that built up over time and has brought us to the current last 6 months or so. With frozen prices, with the inability of with signals against investment, and the fact that you've incentivized economic growth because of some of the policies that the government put in place, the demand for local energy in Argentina soared because the prices were frozen. Basically, long story short, people were not paying the market value of the energy. Windows being left open in the middle of winter to cool the house kind of thing. Oh, the heat's on too high. I'll just open the window to cool the house. I won't turn the heat down because what the heck, I'm barely paying anything, which obviously anyone who's ever been to Venezuela has seen a similar anecdote when it comes to driving an automobile and the cost of petroleum. The point being in Argentina that this began to build up and the government had to turn to importation of liquefied natural gas, in addition to curtailing certain industry and forcing the industry to bear the brunt, the private sector to bear the brunt of these policies. The government had to begin probably 6-8 years ago to increase, to begin importation and subsequently increase importation of liquefied natural gas at spot market prices, at prices that were far above what that country, the country I talked about that was running itself on natural gas by the end of the 90s, should be paying. So these all had impacts, and the fact is that because of the price caps, because of the sort of confrontational attitude, the governmental attitude toward the energy sector, and the lack of the ability of the energy companies to get returns on their investment, you've seen decreases in the production as the demand has spiked domestically. And there's been a price tag for that, for offsetting that imbalance. In different reports, different numbers, the numbers are oftentimes difficult to fully account for in Argentina, but one study I read said the price tag the government had to absorb in terms of this offsetting demand and importation of fuels and energy was about $10 billion last year. So this is not the monetary gains of Bolivia in terms of GDP. This is a huge price tag that they've been paying for several years in Argentina, and it was inevitable that somebody or something was going to happen further, because there was already a very interventionary type policy or posture. Well, in May it happened, and it took the form of nationalization of YPF, and essentially, again, Nelson was a great setup, because what had happened in the 90s in Argentina was similar to that in Bolivia. The national oil company YPF had been partially sold to a private investor, Repsol. Repsol had bought and eventually upped its ownership to 51%. Well, they became a target for the government, and as this domestic production continued to fall, and the fact is that over the last several years it's fallen anywhere from 4 to 5 to 6% in terms of domestic output. And so the government put the target on YPF, saying you're not producing, you need to produce, and if you don't, we're gonna level the boom on you. And they did that in May, and the accusation was that they weren't reinvesting, and YPF was one of the largest reasons why the government had to import so much LNG, why there wasn't enough energy being produced at the domestic level. And so the government and all these things we've talked about decided to take its role and nationalize the company or buy or expropriate the remainder of the privately owned Repsol shares so that it could then develop a program that it says will respond to the citizens' needs to have the energy that they deserve. And by the way, at the prices that the government are still, that are, by the way, at the prices that are still very politically appealing to the Kirchner government. So this has been, like I said, a process and a slow moving train that has been extremely evident to folks who are following it. But what's happened even more recently, it's not that you can't ever take anyone by surprise about what the Kirchner government will do in terms of energy policy, but what happened after the YPF nationalization was that the government continued the platform of that the companies were not investing enough, and the fiscal price tag that the government was assuming therefore was the company's fault, and so there had to be now more intervention on the part of the government in Argentina. Again, the idea to recapture the domestic output of oil and gas production. So between May and June and July, there was all kinds of discussion. Well, ultimately, the government now in July has decided that it will assume oversight of every aspect of the oil and gas production in Argentina. Not that it will nationalize all the companies, but that it is now created by decree a commission that is in charge of managing and approving and sanctioning and basically oversighting all private investment in Argentina. And that's where we are today. It is an extremely interesting situation, and I'll end about Argentina with why it's an extremely interesting situation, and it can be summed up with one word, and that's shale. And David talked about unconventional resources. Charles talked about the shift and this whole idea of the hemisphere. Well, that's all largely to do because of unconventional resources, which are these shale and these oil and gas reserves that have been heretofore difficult, if not impossible, to bring to market. Argentina has the third largest potential of unconventional resources in Latin America. And so therefore, what you're going to see in Argentina is, despite an extremely interventionary, despite an extremely active state role in the entire the aspect of the energy sector, the reserve potential, the opportunity that those reserves offer in Argentina will continue to make investors figure out how they can dance on the head of a pin and how they can try to gain access according to the terms the government has now been very clear about establishing for those unconventional resources. The headlines indicate that the major companies have not shied away. I think folks are trying to understand this decree, whether it's constitutional or not, in terms of the oversight by the government. But the fact is that everything we talked about can be blown out of the water when you have a situation in Argentina that's developed in the last couple of years in terms of the unconventional resource potential. Everything they've done to date, if you didn't have that, would mean Exxon, Chevron, Shell, the whole list would not want anything to do with that country.
That's Thank you. Thank you, Jeremy. Jeremy had asked me to speak for a moment about Venezuela, but I'm not going to. I'm just going to repeat what David said, and that is that it's got the worst, most inefficient state-owned oil company in the world.
A lot of competitors for that.
And if you're interested, I'd be delighted to talk to you about it. You can't stand it anymore. But what I'd prefer to do right now is open the floor to questions. Please, there's microphones. You've got to hit the little button and see the green light come on. Say your name, make your question short, and I promise the answers will be short. Okay, so.
Which is a question?
Right here. Okay, Gus, you're on. Hit the button and speak in the microphone.
Really great summaries. Thank you very much. Nelson, I was curious about the mention of the Uyuni Valley. I know that there's been, like, for example, some Japanese companies that have started doing some testing over there. Do you see the demand for lithium staying so strong that it'll still be sought after and people will figure it out? I know Korea, Japan, and China want to secure the electronics industries. Any news on that front?
The last thing I hear is that yes, there has been some studies from the Japanese, but there is not a proposal really to make the business. The government itself is calling that by 2025 they expect to produce batteries based on lithium, and if possible cars. I mean, that's the wish that they want to do. But we still have to wait what firm really wants to go. I think the problem is that the references of the experience of the government with the Mutum, the iron ore complex, has not been successful. And then I think firms are really very very risk-averse of dealing with the government now. Even Jindal, which is an Indian company, has some fight on the International Agreement Commission in Paris with YPFB because of the promised investment that's not there. I think the only firm that really is working now is Samsung, that has a contract to produce some potassium and urea for 2015. And they committed $800 million, and they expect they're going to do it, and they're going to use just 1.6 trillion cubic feet per day, and that's possible to do it. All the other all the other resources require more than 6 million cubic feet per day, and there's no such investment, and there's no exploration. I mean, there's no way really to support those investments.
Did you want to respond?
Just very briefly, I think almost all these lithium plans in Bolivia are the result of a government that is smoking and inhaling. And I think this is a general problem when we think about where resources are actually going to get extracted as opposed to where they're going to sit underground. There's an amazing amount of all of these resources in the world. Gas is a great example. There's huge amounts of gas in the world. What is lacking is the combination of gas underground and the situation above ground that allows one to make a long-term, high capex, sensitive to changes in regulation and tax investment. And that's the real problem. So that's why the majors are all dancing in Argentina. I'd be shocked if any of them does anything really big in Argentina. There's all kinds of gas in the world. But there are very few places like Trinidad where you have a combination of a lot of gas and a government that kind of credibly made a set of commitments to investors that allowed them to sink the capital. That's the real problem here. And that's why all these lithium plans in Bolivia will always fail.
Yes.
Mary Beth McCabe. There's been a lot of talk this week in San Diego about flex alerts, energy being short here as well. I haven't heard the word solar come up, and I'm wondering, I think of Latin America, I think lots of sun and lots of heat. Is there any renewable energy changes going on in these countries?
Well, solar is the worst case, because solar is a joke for the most part in real economic situations. So